we started Dead Air Live in November of 74, you know, Dead Air. And we said, yeah, we wanted to do it live, so hence the name Dead Air Live. What we did was that we just take an image like this and move it around and think just different crazy effects, anything went. We got a response though. People like the show, you know, who would call in, and we had different people call in. Like, there was one guy called Ray.
Dead Air Live expands your mind. It blows my mind. Good evening and welcome to Dead Air Live. My name is Parrish Dobson and I'm your host for this evening. We've titled our show Talking Art, and we hope it's the first in a series of conversations with artists about their work. Tonight we have two guests, Reginald Jackson, who is a documentary photographer and filmmaker, and in the second half of our show we'll be talking with Rhonda Richards, who is a documentary filmmaker. So we'd like to begin with Reggie Jackson, who is here with me now. Welcome.
Thank you.
I'm very glad you could come. Reggie is a photographer, filmmaker, visual anthropologist as well, which is a term maybe you should explain to us. Mm. And I'll just give a little bit of background. Reggie is working as the professor of communications at Simmons College here in Boston. He holds a degree in graphic design from Yale School of Art and Architecture, and you also have a master's of social work, which is an unusual combination. So if you could tell us first what a visual anthropologist is.
Well, a visual anthropologist uses the camera to explore culture and to be able to illuminate that process visually, primarily. So it gives me the opportunity to use some of the background, some of the skills that I've developed in graphic arts and photography, mm-hmm. as well as my social work experience.
Great.
To travel and to explore culture.
I was curious in terms of your background, starting out as an artist, and then you said you decided to get a master's in social work as well. Could you tell us just a little bit about why that piece came up in your life?
Well, it was nothing that was planned. Mm-hmm. It was something that happened as a result of where I was. And I had spent my graduate school days in the 60s in New Haven, and had become very much politicized by what was going on, and realized coming out of the 60s and into the early 70s that I had no academic or no formal training in the social sciences, outside of a course here and there, and I spent time at Stony Brook, their school of social work there, and began to become more interested in what was going on, and eventually entered the school at 73-74.
Mm-hmm. How do you see your work in photography as a way of applying, in a sense, your social conscience?
Well, it's a direct link in terms of the documentation aspect of it, obviously. And as I begin to try to understand through the camera various aspects of, for instance, community intervention or social change, I began to explore with the camera. So it was sort of a natural link for me to take the camera with me as I was going through that process of community intervention.
Mm-hmm. This is a tough question, but what is your best hope in terms of social change that would come as a result of the documentary photography that you do?
Well, I don't believe that the photography directly changes people's consciousness, but I do feel that it does bring forth information that folks have the opportunity to absorb, and perhaps, you know, will make a difference in how they feel and how they view the world, and hopefully, you know, in a positive way.
Mm-hmm. In terms of the projects before the one that we're going to talk about a lot, which is up right now at Simmons College, previous to this, which of your projects would you say you feel had the most impact or was most interesting to you?
Well, that's a tough question. There are a number of projects that I've worked on that I've, while I was involved in them, felt that they were, you know, perhaps the most exciting. I have worked on the homeless about 4, 5, 6 years ago, and that project in particular involved me for about a year, during which time I spent time in shelters and spent time on the street talking to the homeless. I was also sort of in an advocacy position. We'd gotten a grant from the feds through the Mass Association for Mental Health, and I began making images, and I think that was one of the more compelling projects. Out of that, I began to make images that really attempted to show the homeless as ordinary folk, and I tried to get away from the extremes and sort of the stereotypical view of the homeless as being mentally retarded or people, you know, really unlike anyone else. So as a result, the images that I made were photographs that appeared to be portraits, family portraits.
So it's mm-hmm. a much more compassionate sort of personal look at the homeless.
Mm-hmm.
I was going to ask you, that's almost a moral question for any photographer. How do you resolve the problem of photography, which is, in a sense, taking an image, and how do you deal subject without, in a sense, walking away mm-hmm. with their image? Mm-hmm.
Well, I like to think of it in terms of as instead of taking the picture, sharing the image or sharing mm-hmm. that experience. And so oftentimes a camera isn't involved in the process until much later on in the interaction.
Mm-hmm.
So it might be a day or two or a week or whatever that the camera then becomes a part of what's going on. And one of the things that I do a lot is make Polaroid photographs of people prior to doing any sort of serious work. Not to say that Polaroid isn't or can't be serious, but I spend an awful lot on Polaroid. And passing out images so that people and I connect, at least on that part of it, and then eventually sort of work out a relationship that
right.
We both can feel good about.
Good. Well, I wish we had some of those to show, but we have a lot of other slides that you've brought, largely from your travels in Africa and Brazil. And maybe before we start looking at them, you could tell us what took you to Africa? What was your intention in the photographic work mm-hmm. you did there and in Brazil?
Well, originally I went to Africa to dispel many of the myths that existed about Africa. You know, as growing up as a child and the grade schools and so forth, there were no really positive images about Africa. Mm-hmm. And so when I had the opportunity to go, I really wanted to present some positive images. And so I was looking more at the beauty rather than the extremes that exist in Africa right now. So the early work dealt with that aspect, and then eventually, having produced that type of image, I began to look at cross-cultural influences and how some of them are accommodated. And out of that, I began to move more towards African retentions or African survivals. And I began to look at how the African experience impacts and influences in a major way the culture of the world.
Mm-hmm.
And so I began to look for vestiges of African retentions or survivals through the religious form of expression.
Wherever you might find it, whether it be in Brazil or
mm-hmm.
Cuba. I understand you went to Cuba.
Mm-hmm. Nicaragua,
mm-hmm.
as well as Cambridge or Roxbury or wherever else
Good.
I may happen to be.
Well, why don't we start looking at the slides and
okay.
Perhaps you can tell us something about them as we go through them.
Mm-hmm. This first image is of the Benin ceremonial mask. It's a replica of the Benin mask that was used for the Second World Festival of African Arts and Culture in 1977 in Lagos, Nigeria. The following images are images that were taken in West Africa on the continent. It was an attempt to just try to
locate us, yeah.
Locate you. These are photographs of photographs. Some of the faces and places. This is West Africa. It's a typical market woman, a Muslim trader. Very typical scene.
When you first went to Africa, what struck you the most?
I think, going to Ghana as the first stop, I was struck by my familiarity mm-hmm. with the way people felt towards me and me towards them. It was just astounding. I really feel that my ancestors came from Ghana because
I felt at home right away.
I felt very much at home. Mm-hmm. That was very, very remarkable. I had never really traveled outside of the country, outside of maybe Canada. And so to go someplace like that and be immediately sort of accepted, mm-hmm. I'd heard some things about, would you really sort of blend in and not knowing the languages and so forth, whether you could really sort of feel at home. But I really didn't have any problems like that. Mm-hmm. This is a shot from a two-day Muslim wedding that went on in Accra, the Zongo area of Accra in Ghana, which is the capital, Accra. This is from a Homowo festival, a celebration by the Ga people that happens in August every year. They're wearing kente cloth, this is the first point at which I experienced or encountered the Orishas. This is a Babalu Aye, an Orisha that comes out of the Yoruba tradition.
Would you explain to us what the term Orisha is?
Orisha is a word for deity or a mini god, if you will, in the Yoruba pantheon. There are a series of these deities or Orishas that have particular domains and are responsible for various aspects of life. And this was 1970 that I saw this particular manifestation of this Orisha in a festival. And so later on in Brazil, I saw the same deity in a
and
festival.
This is from Africa, too.
No, this is here.
Okay, I was going to say,
What I'm doing is I'm flipping back and forth between Africa and here, right. And looking at the religious, musical tradition. This mm-hmm. is a slide of Duke Ellington, just taken in 1972.
And that's so beautiful.
Earlier, we saw a slide of Lionel Hampton and Sachimo on the side of a building in Ghana. So that this sort of cross-cultural influence piece is very very much alive.
And very much your subject. That seems mm-hmm. to be where you're really focusing. Mm-hmm.
These are fishermen, and I've done a whole series on fishermen along the Ghana coast, and it's one of the sort of oldest forms of sort of glue that keeps people together, mm-hmm. That sort of also coordinates with the Orisha Yemenja, who is responsible for those things that happen in the sea. And those colors are blue.
I see certainly that your interest is both very much in the faces and the people you were meeting and in the vibrancy of the landscape.
Mm-hmm. This is OT River, one of the largest largest man-made bodies of water in the world, created by the Akasambo Dam. This is one of the forts along the Ghana coast which was used during the slave trade, the transatlantic slave trade. Mm. There are a whole series of slides here that deal with the dungeons and where people were kept during the prior to the Middle Passage in the transatlantic slave system. This is what it looked like in one of those dungeons when people were held. This is the outer view of the Atlantic. This is Cape Coast Castle. These are some kids that I took to Africa with me in 1974 as part of a program that I helped develop when I was working on my social work degree. And we were able to take a group of 15 youngsters to West Africa for 3 weeks.
That must have been amazing for them.
Oh, it was. Yeah. It was. They still talk about this trip. They're watching other kids play a game, and here they're discussing what was going on. We're moving now into Nigeria, and this is FESTAC, the World Festival of African Arts and Culture, that happened in 77, and there were many countries involved in that. There were performances, there were colloquia, as well as just a varied assortment of activities that went on for almost 2 months. These are the Guinea performers. So the women from Zambia, the women from Mauritania, the Cubans, the Senegalese, the Zairians.
These are all color. You work in black and white as well?
Yes. I sort of pick and choose when it's appropriate.
Right.
I try to find the appropriate medium.
Uh-huh. Now, are your slides on your current exhibit coming up, or are we almost there?
Yes, this is Brazil. Yeah. Uh-huh. Or actually, this is not Brazil. This is Nigeria, and this is an Ifa ceremony, which is directly related to the exhibit that's up now, and it. Is a festival that, or actually it's a ritual that occurs whereby you're able to, as a participant, communicate with the higher order. And so this religion has built into it a way to interact and get information about, you know, about various questions that one might ask.
I wanted to maybe move our conversation to your current work, which is, as I mentioned earlier, up at the Simmons Art Gallery for the whole month of November. And it struck me when I saw it as a very unusual exhibit in that it's not strictly documentary at all. You're taking a sort of three-phased approach to your interest in this religious ceremonial religion, rather, in Brazil.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe we could just begin by saying, why is this so fascinating to you? What's the draw?
The draw is that for years there's been a great deal of debate about to what extent there are any vestiges of African culture in the African-American experience, given the horrors that existed in slavery. And so it was my attempt to try to bring clarity to that discussion. And as a visual anthropologist, I'm pursuing the visual side of this argument. And my platform is that, or my position is that there are very, very significant vestiges of African culture that exist, and that and oftentimes we're not aware of it. And that if I could present from a visual side the argument, then there would be less debate about this fact.
The importance of African traditions.
Mm-hmm.
Can we move along to those slides?
I think we will probably. This is in Nigeria, and this is at the Oni of Ife's palace, where the religion began, the Yoruba religion began centuries ago. Mm-hmm. These are some of the traditional leaders right. at a national conference.
Good. We have.
This is the this is the Oni Avife, who's the chief person right. involved.
Let's see. In our last mm-hmm. 2 minutes, mm-hmm. Maybe we could get mm-hmm. to our see some of that because I think it's so interesting. You've, in a sense, extended documentary mode by working with manipulated images mm-hmm. and instead of simply recording what you see, you've taken a kind of a personal interpretation of mm-hmm. some of the principles of the religion mm-hmm. as you see them manifested in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Here's an example of the manipulated image. Would you tell us about this one?
This is a posterized image, and it's done during a festival for Ashumare, who was responsible for the waterfalls and for those things that happen between the sky and the ocean in a supernatural way. And so what I've done is I've taken a black and white photograph and separated out the values from black to white and then added color and then put it back together to get the energy and to show some of the vitality involved.
This is another. These are dancers.
This is Yansan, the deity of the wind. This is Umulu, who we saw earlier as Babaluaye in Ghana, but this is now Brazil.
Mm-hmm.
This is my posterization of Umulu. And I've added the butterfly as a sign of life. Umulu is responsible for warding off plagues and is associated with smallpox. This is Ogun, another deity, who's a warrior and is considered to his colors are blue and is considered to be a very important deity in Brazil. This is a piece I call Transformation, where Babla Risha, or Father of the Saints, is moving from sort of a normal state to a possessed state, or is mounted by this Orisha.
Mm-hmm.
This is Oshumare. This is Messias as Oshumare. This is another posterized image.
I find this work very interesting and quite dynamic, the way you've added a kind of visual energy to your imagery to heighten the effect on mm-hmm. the viewer.
Oftentimes I've tried to deal with the business of aura and how people exude a certain kind of persona.
Right.
And so I've tried to get that right. into the work.
Well, I hope our audience can get to the gallery. We mm-hmm. have to conclude our conversation. I know you did want to speak just maybe for 10 seconds on the Olaleye Communications, who sponsored your exhibit. Would you say one thing?
Yes, Olaleye is a nonprofit organization that's set up to support artists, historians, and scholars who are doing cultural visual research.
Mm-hmm.
And we're based in Lower Roxbury and are the movers behind this exhibit. And this exhibit is the first major thing that we've done. We're involved at the Blackstone School and doing curriculum development for the fifth graders around the exhibit. And hope to do other things.
Terrific. Well, mm-hmm. good luck to you, and thank you so much for coming.
Thank
Stay
you.
Tuned, and we'll be coming back to talk with Rhonda Richards, who is a documentary filmmaker. Thank you. welcome back to the studio. We're now here with Rhonda Richards, who is a documentary filmmaker who is currently teaching at Boston Film and Video Foundation and also works as a freelance filmmaker in the greater Boston area. Welcome, Rhonda.
Hi.
Glad you could come. Why don't you tell us a little bit about your background as a filmmaker? How did you get into filmmaking? Where did you study? Whatever is appropriate.
Well, it was a mistake. I went to film school at the Evergreen State College in Olympia, Washington. And prior to that, I was studying social psychology. And I was just at the point where I was going to have to take statistics courses. And I decided I didn't want to do that. So in fact, I was supposed to be studying for an exam in that subject. And I went to the periodical section instead and somehow came across filmmaking magazines. And I started looking in the back and looking at all the equipment, and I thought,
this is for you.
That looks interesting. And it just so happened that one of the state colleges, Evergreen, had a film program that I had been hearing some things about, so I jumped ship.
Well, good for you. And you wound up in documentary film, and maybe you could tell us, in terms of the sort of documentary tradition, where does your work fall? How do you describe your own work?
Well, I consider my work a type of watered-down cinema verite, or direct cinema, which was a movement in the 60s that had some proponents that were here in the Boston area. In fact, Frederick Wiseman and Ricky Leacock. Mm-hmm. When I was in film school, we were seeing a lot of their work. And if you know what that looks like, mm-hmm. It's pretty much the fly-on-the-wall type of filmmaking where the filmmaker comes into a situation and documents it as purely as possible and doesn't try to interact or disrupt the situations. I do that to a certain extent, but I also direct things in the sense that I will set up interviews and ask people off camera questions and, I guess, direct them more overtly in that sense. Okay. So it's a combination of both styles.
Right. And you seem to be interested in animals, you said. You've got a film that we're going to get to see, which is about Groundhog Day in a small town in Pennsylvania. How did you get interested in this kind of subject? Why animals or a focus on animals?
The first film I made was about cat shows. And at the time I was making that, a filmmaker came to visit the school I was attending, and she talked about this trilogy of films she was making. And I was, you know, very impressed by that, and I thought, well, I'm going to make a trilogy of films. So the first one was about animals, and I really, you know, liked animals. So I thought, well, the next film I'm going to make should probably be about animals, too, so that I could have this series of short films. And the groundhog was next.
How did you find the groundhog, or the groundhog find you?
Well, that's a long story, too. When I was in second grade, we used to get weekly readers. Maybe you did,
right,
too.
Yep.
And around Groundhog Day, on the back of your weekly reader, that's where you got to do the fun things. And the girl next to me was coloring her groundhog with, like, a blue crayon, the photograph of the groundhog. And I remember that really disturbed me, because although I'd never seen this animal, I knew it wasn't blue. And also in my neighborhood, we had a set of twins, and they were born on Groundhog Day. And so we always knew that it was their birthday because it was their birthday and because it was Groundhog Day. So from way back, it had these sort of...
It had a meaning for you. And then how did you find this particular small town in Pennsylvania where the groundhog is so important?
Well, I went to the library here in Cambridge, and I looked up this book called The Book of Holidays. And there was an address for the Chamber of Commerce in Punxsutawney, Pennsylvania, and I wrote them. And within a week, I got back this large manila envelope that had these groundhog prints stamped across the envelope, and I just looked at that and I said, oh, this is it, I'm going to do this. Okay. I hadn't even seen the inside, but
great.
I knew it was...
Well, we're great. About to see the film. Is there anything you'd like to say as an introduction to it?
Have fun. It's supposed to be funny. That's usually how I introduce
you
it,
take
is
a kind
that
of
it's okay to laugh.
Humorous, ironic approach to Groundhog Day in Pennsylvania.
Right.
Okay, well, we're ready to go to the tape then.
I have here before me a study on groundhogs over a period of 3 years in Pennsylvania, from 1957 through 1959, by an animal expert, namely Dr. Snyder. In 1957, I set out with little enthusiasm on February 2nd and was more than a bit surprised when I found unmistakable evidence of an active woodchuck in the form of mud freshly excavated from a burrow entrance. The woodchuck's prints were clear in the soft mud, and I was also rewarded by an actual sighting of this particular animal at high noon the same day. This animal saw his shadow without a doubt, for it was a bright, sunny, wintry day. Only a few animals were active during the first week of February, but the number increased towards the middle of the month in 1958. The local residents missed Groundhog Day completely, but only by one day. In 1959, they were one day early. In retrospect, even scientists would have to admit that February 2nd is the accurate date for the emergence from hibernation of all groundhogs, and especially Punxsutawney Phil.
And every place we go, once we mention Punxsutawney, they said, oh, we know Punxsutawney, that's where the groundhog is.
And you know, there's a lot of competitors around the country. But this is truly the seer of seers.
Number one. The others are just fakes.
Phonies, counterfeits, copycats. You truly come to see the seer of seers.
I mean, it's sort of amazing that a town of this size, only 8,000 people, can get this kind of publicity one day out of the year with a groundhog. But they were the first ones to jump on it, and they had the idea, and they're the ones that are the most famous, Punxsutawney Phil. And it certainly is the hot spot in the country on February 2nd every year. Everybody focuses their attention right here just to see what one little groundhog is going to do as far as seeing his shadow or not to prognosticate the rest of the winter weather. So it is something, and you have to give them credit. Very aggressive public relations for a town this size.
Good morning, Bill Nell at the Chamber of Commerce in Punxsutawney. Flint, Michigan, well, we'd be happy to talk with you and tell you about Punxsutawney Phil.
My name is Carol Dale, and I'm Secretary of the Chamber of Commerce in Punxsutawney. We have several items here that we sell that are about our groundhog, which is, of course, the worldwide and renowned groundhog.
So the first trek was made in 1887, and Phil made his fearless forecast at that time. Now, he's been doing it for 97 years.
Here we have our poppet. This is a fairly new item. Our local radio announcer's wife makes these, and they cannot be bought anyplace else.
Happy Groundhog Day, WPXZ. Hi, how you doing? Oh, tired, but enjoying it. A busy, busy day. Well, the news isn't good as far as Punxy Phil, and we'll give you the full thing here on our feet on our story, okay? All right, it's 43 seconds long. If you're ready, here we go. In 3, 2, 1.
Jane Cunningham. I manage the Panel Hotel in downtown Punxsutawney, right beside the town park. We're right in the center of all activity of Punxsutawney, but particularly the groundhog activities. On Groundhog's Day, we get most of the newsmen and media who come to handle all the news and television, radio, all the events of Groundhog's Day. We also get an awful lot of attention all year with people coming through Punxy. Anyone in this area wants to come and see where the groundhog lives, see all the sites that there are in Punxsutawney because of the groundhog. It isn't just a one-day or a two-day affair for Punxsutawney, it's all year round.
And we do have Punxsutawney Phil available in a groundhog zoo that people can see him all summer long. Yeah, it's in the Civic Center, and he's air conditioned and has his own vet, and he's beautiful. Thousands of people come to see him.
This is our stuffed groundhog. We've had him for a long time, and he's just more or less our mascot.
And each summer on the second week of August, we have a groundhog picnic, and of course Phil drinks a special groundhog punch, and with each sip that he takes, he gains 7 years longevity.
That's one.
Bourbon in it.
Oh, there he is.
Up,
he doesn't like that.
Don't drown.
Okay.
You got three sips?
You got three sips.
Right. That's a boy.
21 more years. Keep it up.
He likes you. He'll give more.
Got it. Okay, got some.
His heart's really beating.
Want to give another little shot?
Try one.
Well, it's not approved by the FDA, and I've hesitated to try it myself, but he's good into the 22nd century.
Newspaper and radio and all the news media. In just a few minutes, we're going to have Phil come out.
Might I add that whether you have fat groundhogs or skinny groundhogs depends on how thick or thin you roll out your dough. I usually prefer a rather slimmed down groundhog, but it won't hurt if they're nice, fat, chubby little fellows, because groundhogs like people come in all shapes and sizes.
Then we have golf balls. The golf balls have a groundhog on one side, and they have Punxsutawney Phil written on the other side.
The cookie has a little currant eye, and it has a little egg glaze. And I have baked them. I think I have baked thousands and thousands of groundhog cookies at this point. It's a nice cookie. You don't waste any dough. The only trouble is that the dough is a soft dough, and if you want to work with it, you have to work with it while it's cold.
Now, we do have a lot of people that want to enter in onto the coattails of Punxsutawney Phil. Some of them try to forecast weather by looking at a jar and with a woolly worm in it and try to decide whether it's going to be winter or spring.
These seem to be holding up pretty well. And then I'll show you how we glaze them. But it has now given Punxsutawney, beyond the story of Punxsutawney Phil, there now is something that people all over the world can make to celebrate Groundhog Day. And it is interesting to know that there are groundhog parties everywhere and that people do bake groundhog cookies and they do celebrate with them. So if I have any lasting gift for humanity, I presume it will be the groundhog cookie.
But Punxsutawney Phil is the one and only official groundhog weather forecaster.
The official Punxsutawney Groundhog coloring book is set up locally. One of our local teachers has done the coloring book. He has it published himself.
As you can see, these are the finishing touches for the little groundhogs. Hoggy wouldn't look quite the same if he didn't get his shiny coat. All right, we're going to set the eyes in very carefully because, after all, you wouldn't want a cross-eyed groundhog. And you want to be sure the eye stays in because you wouldn't want a blind groundhog. So once we have the last little eyes in, we will place the groundhogs in the oven where they will take approximately 12 minutes to bake. And they're rather fascinating to watch if you have an oven with a glass door, because they kind of pop up and then they sink down. You can kind of watch them grow fast and crinkly.
Thank you.
Francis. Go to the plea. Good morning to all.
Okay.
Hear ye, hear ye. To all faithful followers assembling here in Gobbler's Knob and to all believers around the world, I, James H. Means, president of the Punxsutawney Groundhog Club, hereby proclaim that His Imperial Majesty King Philip has emerged from his royal burrow at 7:20 a.m. In the dimness of the early winter dawn, he stood for a moment tall and proud. Then, in seconds, he saw a thin gray shadow over his right shoulder. In this year of 1984, Punxsutawney Phil has indeed seen a shadow that indicates 6 more weeks of mild winter weather still ahead of us. Just
the worst is over, but there will be 6 more weeks of winter weather. That's the word today from Punxsutawney, Pennsylvania, where Punxsutawney Phil, the official weather forecasting groundhog, saw his shadow. Jim Means, Punxsutawney Groundhog Club president, made it official from Gobbler's Knob just outside town.
In this year, 1984, Punxsutawney Phil has indeed seen a shadow that indicates 6 more weeks of mild winter weather are still ahead of us.
Even though 6 more weeks of winter weather has been predicted, Phil wants all his loyal followers to know that better days are coming. Bob Curry reporting from Punxsutawney, Pennsylvania, the home of the only reliable weather forecasting groundhog.
Did you get that? How'd it sound? Yeah, well, hey, I'm not responsible for what he sees or doesn't see. Yeah, well, 6 more weeks, it's not that long. All right, well, thanks for calling. All right, have a good day. Right, okay, bye-bye.
Here they are, just perfect. And we'll give them a moment or two to set because we don't want sway back groundhogs either. Groundhog cookies are like little girls, full of sugar and spice and everything nice. A few Siamese twin groundhogs here, but we'll just operate on them very easily.
Bumper sticker that can be purchased for on your car.
All right, you got it direct. Thank you. Chamber of Commerce, Bill Nall speaking.
Okay, yeah, it's rolling.
Okay, go ahead.
It won't take very long.
Okay. Go ahead.
You got him in the mic?
Yeah.
All right, Phil, Casey sent me down here. We both know that it's not the shadow that's your secret. What is it Casey needs to know your secret? How do you do it?
With his large and official coterie, he puts on a delightfully different ceremony. Where? At Punxsutawney. Punxsutawney, PA. the one and only Punxsutawney Phil. Here he comes. Move over. Step aside. Make way for the honorable, the one and only Punxsutawney Phil.
Here we are back in the studio with the filmmaker of the film you just saw, Seer of Seers. Rhonda, that's a very funny film, filled with all kinds of gentle irony. It seems as if the people are having a good time, and you're just recording it, but you're also sort of pointing out a kind of silliness about this whole thing.
Much Ado About Nothing.
Much Ado About Nothing. Did you have fun making this film?
Yeah. My favorite part was getting to hold the groundhog, though.
Well, good for you. And it didn't bite.
Mm-mm.
Oh, good. This film has been in some film festivals. Has it, can, for example, where do people get to see this film?
It's been in some film festivals, the American Film Festival, Chicago International Film Festival, some good festivals, but probably the most attention it drew was when it was shown here in Boston at the New England Film Festival. So that was nice that it got shown at home and that people responded to it.
Well, great. Have the people in Punxsutawney, if I said it right, have they seen the film?
They've seen it many times, and they don't quite see it the way everyone else does, of course, which is always an interesting aspect of documentary. But they enjoy it, mm-hmm. and they always wonder why there isn't more of the groundhog in it and less of them.
Is it your intention to show a kind of slight mockery of this Much Ado About Nothing activity that human beings can get into around animals, or how would you describe your intention?
It's not mockery, but it's definitely taking a look at relationships between people and animals. And that's a complicated thing, really. It's something that social scientists right now are really beginning to take a look at. What is that relationship, and why has it been so prevalent over time in so many cultures? And it's really research that's coming out just in the last 10 or 15 years, sort of looking at that issue. And I don't really have any particular theories or answers about that. I know it's, for me, a very interesting way to look at people.
In terms of just something they relate to every day and what it reveals about
Human nature. Mm. Right.
Okay. Well, that was a lot of fun to watch. How would someone on the street or someone watching this show ever get to see your films?
Well, let's see. Probably the best thing to do would be to contact Boston Film and Video Foundation. Two of the projects I'm working on now, I'm involved with that organization in getting the work done. And they have copies of these films over there, and that's one way. Once you finish a film and it goes on the festival circuit, there's a time period where it's out there and being shown, and then sort of once that time period ends, you get to show them to your friends, mm-hmm. and they sit in your closet.
That's good. I wanted to ask you, actually, going back to the actual making of the film, how many people are you working with when you're on site? Is it you? How many other people?
It's myself and usually one other person. I believe pretty strongly in using very small crews. I think when you bring a lot of people in there, it ends up being about you and the production and not so much about the subject matter that you're trying to capture. So I do my own audio recording, and I work with a camera person, and that's usually pretty much it. Mm-hmm. And the relationship between the camera person or cinematographer is an important one, because as you see, a lot of this observational footage that you're gathering, you really need to rely on someone that has sort of the same vision, point of view, and approach that you do, because mm-hmm. you're kind of cutting them loose and letting them gather images.
Right. So for the amount of time you're in the field, how much time were you down in Pennsylvania shooting this?
I was there for, two days before the event, the day of the event, and then a day after.
And then how much time did you spend compiling the film we just saw?
Months and months and months.
So the ratio is of time in the field versus time editing is staggering, really, isn't
it? Right, yeah. Right. We call the editing room the land that time forgot. You really spend a lot of time in there.
Do you enjoy that part of it as well?
That's actually the part I enjoy most.
Why?
Because that's, I don't go out into the field with a lot of preconceptions. I go out and sort of throw a wide net and gather a lot of material. If I'm curious about it, if I think this person is good and has something to say, I put them on camera. Then once you're in the editing room, that's where you really start to create the film, or the film starts to take shape, and you see relationships between your ideas and some surprises, some things you didn't really know were there.
Right. Well, we're about to see a segment of a work in progress, and maybe you could describe to us what we're about to see.
Well, the film is, the working title is Bag Bomb, and it's about a 100-year-old cow product, or ointment, that they use to put on chapped and irritated cow udders. And people use it too, and they always have. If you lived in rural areas or on dairy farms, it's just something that was in the barn but also ended up in the family medicine cabinet. Because as people milked the cows, they realized that the ointment also had very healing effects on their hands. And they started using it for chapped hands and chapped lips, and from there it went into other deviations such as squeaky bed springs and waterproofing boots, etc. And in 1984, a writer for the New York Times wrote an article about this product, a quite lengthy one, and since that time he's actually been selling as much or more of the product to people than to...
Who are not farmers and are nowhere near cows.
Right. So the scene that's coming up is actually a golf tournament that's held in just north of Seattle, Washington. And it's a group of people that are avid fans of this product, and they have a tournament that they host called the Bag Bomb Invitational Golf Tournament.
Well, let's go to that segment of Rhonda's work in progress called Bag Bomb.
You ask how this Bag Bomb Invitational Golf Tournament got started. Originally, about 1972, some years back, I had a whole house full of people that I didn't know what to do with. And I could imagine trying to entertain 20 adults for 3 extended days. They nearly all golfed, and we got out in the golf course and played golf. And I was stuck with what to give them for a prize. So the grand prize for the best golfer all day was a 10-ounce can of Bag Bomb. After the person that received it was totally amazed and never seen such a thing, couldn't imagine what he was going to do with a can of grease, and it got to be so much fun that I decided to write to the Dairy Association Company in Vermont and tell them about our golf tournament, ask them if I could formally call it the Bag Bomb Tournament. We ended up having Mr. Norris not only endorse our tournament, but he comes out faithfully every year and plays in the tournament. We all enjoy his presence as much as we do Bag Bomb.
It's still going!
Everybody uses Bag Bomb for one thing or another. That's really the spirit of the whole thing, that they all use it, they enjoy it as a vehicle to get together.
One day I had a burn, one day I had a sore. I used Bag Bomb on both of them, and now they are no more. Bag Bomb Blues, say it loud and clear. Let's hear it for our favorite sound. Come on, let's shout and cheer. Whoa!
Phil. I'll show you how to miss him.
Attaboy. Oh.
Come on.
It's tongue-in-cheek, good friends, good golf, and good bag bomb.
Welcome back to the studio. Rhonda, how will you complete that film, and where do you get the money for projects like this?
How will I complete that? That's a good question. The funding situation in this state is it's really hard right now, given what's happened to the Mass Council of Arts and Humanities. And because of that particular situation and other situations like it on the national scene, it's held up this project for 2 years now. So I'm totally open to ideas as to how you fund something like this.
It's a problem for artists all across Massachusetts. And then just quickly, you have in mind another project coming up, which I think is quite interesting. You want to tell us about that briefly?
The working title for that project is called You Dirty Rat? ? I'm working with a friend of mine and filmmaker, Michael Majoris, and it looks at the rat situation surrounding the Third Harbor Tunnel and Central Artery Project. And we're just getting started on that.
So you're going to be down there under the tunnel photographing workers, rats, and the impact of rats on the community.
That's right.
We look forward to it. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
And I wish you good night for Dead Air Live. I hope you'll tune in to us another time.